So welcome back, everyone. Now we are going to start the third lecture today. So Axel Kleinschmidt will continue his lectures on scattering, string scattering amplitudes. So please.
Thank you very much. Last time we were computing some tree level string amplitudes in the open and closed superstring. And I just wrote here to remind you of the results we obtained in this way. So for example, we looked at the 4-point amplitude in the open superstring, which where the massless states consist of gluons or gauge bosons. And there was a formula because of the gauge factor that you have to take care of the gauge color generator. So the TA here, they are the operators of the gauge group. And since it's an open string and we're tree level, the operators are sitting on the boundary of the disk. There's a cyclic order on the boundary of the disk. So you factor this out and what you're left with is called the sub amplitude. And this is given just by the remaining terms, which don't have any more the color. And since it's cyclic, you can fix one point and the other ones you have to then symmetrize over to get the full structure. So this is sort of the first consideration you have to do for thinking about this open string amplitude. And then what we computed last time was this particular sub amplitude with this ordering of points, 1, 2, 3, 4 for 4 points in the superstring by doing the vertex operators. And we saw there was sort of a kinematic part, which was a certain contraction of what we called F to the fourth, which was a way of writing certain momentum and polarization dependence. And this factored out very nicely of the calculation. And then the remaining integral, which had to do with the puncture of the vertex operator, led to this quotient of gamma functions, which is very similar to the Veneziano amplitude for the tachyons in the bosonic string. So this was the result for the 4-gluon amplitude in the open string at tree level. And then we also computed the 4-point amplitude for the closed superstring, where the massless states, for instance, are gravitons. And the formula that came out there was, again, something that contained just the polarization, the kinematic part of the scattering process. So R to the fourth, or R, stands for the Riemann tensor. And this is a certain combination of polarization of the external graviton and its momentum. And it's contracted in a certain way that I'm not, that I wrote last time, with this tensor T8 that also appears for the open string. And then the remaining integral, again, led to just a quotient of gamma functions, which now looks like this. So these were the results that we obtained just by doing the explicit amplitude calculation last time. And then at the end of the last lecture, we started talking about the connection, the relation between the open and the closed string scattering amplitudes. And the picture that goes back to Kawai, Llewellyn, and Tai that I mentioned is the following. So the closed string amplitudes, they are given by integrals over the sphere with punctures. And now if you have this integral over the sphere with punctures, what you can imagine is you take the sphere and cut it into two halves along the punctures. And then the two halves of the sphere, they are topologically the same thing as disks. And now the operators sit on the boundary of these disks. So this gives you the idea that a closed string amplitude that I'm calling M here should factorize into a product of two open string amplitudes, where each of the two halves of the sphere, so the two disks, correspond to an open string amplitude. But now since the operators are on the boundary of the disk, and the boundary of the disk can be ordered, this picture also requires you to sum over the permutations of the ordering of the vertex operator on the boundary of the disk. And as always with these tree-level calculations, since you can fix 3 points, you only have to sum over permutations of n minus 3 points. And then the way that you put together these two disk integrals or two open string amplitudes is you take one permutation on the one side, another permutation on the other side, and then you need this matrix, which is called the KLT matrix, that merges them together. So this is the sort of the rough picture that I was mentioning last time for the relation between open and closed string amplitudes. And now I want to make this formula more concrete. Okay, so first of all, let me give you an idea of how you make this more concrete. The point is that, so the integral over the sphere, what this looks like is an integral d squared 2z. So this is in the picture where the sphere is just the complex plane. So you're integrating over the complex plane, which you can write as an integral over dx and dy, where z is x plus iy decomposed into real and imaginary part. And now these two real integrals, or these two integrals over the real and the imaginary part, those you want to think of the integrals that enter in the open string calculation. So these should be like the boundary integrals of the vertex operator insertions. However, there's a little caveat with that, which is that this is the y integral is the imaginary part of the coordinate on the sphere, and you would rather like this to be more of a real variable. So what you have to do is you have to analytically continue or rotate y into, so this is meant to be a y, y into I times y in order to have both integrals resemble like a real part of a complex variable. And if you do it this way, you can interpret both integrals as boundaries or as open string integrals. Let me make this even more precise. So let's say in the 4-point example, the important thing in this integral was this Kober-Nielsen factor, which was just given by the norm of z minus 2s minus 2, the norm of 1 minus z, and then minus 2u minus 2. So this is the function that we had to integrate in the closed string. So this was in the closed string. This is the z variable. And this function here clearly has singularities at zero, or branch cuts even at zero and one. And now, since we want to go to the picture where all the boundaries line up on the, where all the punctures line up on the boundary of this cut that we're making, we can look, for example, at the ordering where this point z sits in between zero and one. So let's say for z between zero and one, what we want to what we're integrating over for this boundary would be then the y integral, the original y integral would be along this trajectory here, because this is the imaginary part of y when z, sorry, the imaginary part of z when z is between zero and one. And this integral we want to now rotate to line up along the real axis. So what we can do, of course, we can just rotate, but we have to be careful with the singularities of the integrand. So the way that we want to rotate it is to bring it to the real axis, but just by rotating this line more and more, the contour that we end up with will be this one here. So we can't just go over the singularities. We have to be careful with the singularities. So this is the integral that we get from the analytic continuation. And now once we're in this picture, what you can check is that here, this part of the contour, there was no singularity. So what you could do is you could try to just bend this over here and close the contour going the other way. If you do this, you do not cross any additional singularities of the integrand. So so you close the contour or deform the contour by going to the following picture. So here the singularities stay where they are, and now the contour will be just going like this, once around this pole, which is at z equal to zero. But then you know that from the branch cut, if you want to do this integral, you get contributions from the monodromy, from the multi-valuedness of the function. So you get contributions which are e to the I pi times s up here and e to the minus I pi s on the lower sheet. So this comes just from here you have this branch cut singularity at the origin, and if you go between the two sheets, you get a factor of e to the I pi on one side and e to the minus I pi on the other side. And the contribution that you get from this then, of course, is you have to combine the two. So it's e to the pi s minus e to the minus I pi s, which is basically the sine function of pi s. So you from this argument, which is not, I mean, I didn't give all the coefficients and all the exact details, but you get an idea that from this rotation, in order to go to two closed string integrals, you pick up these monodromies from the singularities of the integrand, in this case, the Kober-Nielsen factor, which is always there. And so this KLT matrix that you're expecting should be built out of trigonometric functions. Trigonometric functions. So this is what you get from this complex analysis consideration. And in the four-point case, you can make this completely precise. That's why I was reminding you of the formulas that we had for the four-point scattering amplitudes. So let's look at this to see what the KLT matrix becomes for the four gluon and four graviton amplitude. So on the closed string side, we had the formula which was completely symmetric under STU interchange and looked like so. So I'm not writing the kinematic part, I'm only writing the gamma functions. So this was the closed string side. And on the open string side, one of the orderings, the one that I wrote on the reminder, gave the this is 1, 2, U gave this amplitude for the four gluons, and this is only one half of the sphere integral, so we also need to do something for the other half. And when you think about it for a bit, you realize that here you want to have a slightly different ordering, which is also what I wrote in the KLT formula. This is now doesn't matter. Sorry, I'm just seeing this. There might be a Let me scroll back to what I wrote upstairs. There might be a small inconsistency in what I wrote. So here we had S, T, and U. Sorry, I have to check some. My notes are, there's a typo in my notes. so this is ST. Okay. So here we will have 1 plus T. And you see that these two sides, if I just multiply them in this way, they clearly do not agree. So there's a discrepancy here. So this is only equal if you put in an additional factor of 1 divided by, so let's see, so there's a gamma minus s, which is too much because it's appearing twice here and only once on this side. And there's another factor which is missing, which is gamma 1 plus s, which is on the left-hand side in the denominator, but not on the right-hand side. So if I multiply these things together, then clearly it's just an algebraic identity. And now there is a functional identity for the gamma function, which allows you to simplify this thing. So the functional identity says that this expression here is equal to sinus of pi times s divided by pi. So this is a standard property of the gamma function. And actually, when you look at where this identity comes from, it comes from exactly an argument of the type I was doing before with the monotremies and complex analysis. But now, this is the fully precise incarnation of what I was saying in general, what the relation between closed and open string should be, namely that you have two open string amplitudes, but in slightly different orderings. And there is a matrix that connects the two, which is built out of trigonometric functions. So in this case, this is the KLT matrix. So this is a completely general behavior for tree-level amplitudes. So let's write this, the summary of this thing here. So this means that this 4-point graviton amplitude, I mean up to factors, is the same as one open string amplitude. Then there is this factor of sinus pi s. And then there is another open string amplitude. And when you look at the way the Mandelstam variables are written up there, you realize that the change of Mandelstam variables I was doing is due to a change of the order of points, which is that you flip two points. And which ones you flip is, of course, doesn't matter because of cyclicity. So the formula I wrote upstairs corresponds to this flip here, where you flip these two points. So this is now the KLT formula for 4 points. And similar KLT representations exist for any closed string amplitude. Because this picture with the monodromies and cutting the sphere that I was doing, you can make this completely precise in any case. And this is what was done in the original KLT paper. And so you can find these representations for anything. And actually, this when I say any closed string amplitude, I also include in this statement bosonic or heterotic string amplitudes where you could do something similar. This is now a string theory property of scattering amplitudes at tree level. So maybe I should emphasize tree here. This whole discussion is about trees. And this formula here is very much related to something that you most probably will have heard of. Namely, this is related to the so-called double copy or Bern Carrasco Johansson representation of field theory amplitudes. So this double copy representation of field theory amplitudes is something that has been extremely powerful for computing ultraviolet properties of different field theories, in particular n equals 4 super symmetric Young-Mills and n equals 8 supergravity in four dimensions, and studying whether certain amplitudes diverge or not. And this program of this double copy for field theory amplitudes is something that also extends to loop order, where it's known sort of how to tweak this prescription that I was showing you for field theory amplitudes. And I should say already now that the generalization of the KLT representation in string theory is something that is known at tree level, but it's not known how to generalize this to loop levels. So this there's a relation which you can make completely precise between these two methods at tree level. But one side, namely the field theory side, is known how to use it also at loop level. For the string scattering amplitude, it's not known how to do the same analysis at loop level. So this field theory limit is something that we will come to in more detail in the next section. But before we go there, this sort of summarizes this KLT discussion, and let me pause for a second to see if there are any questions.
Yeah. Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Okay. So about the derivation of this sine pi s, that integral involving, you know, changing the contour and so on, I mean, is it from the integration over the location of the puncture or?
Yes, very good. So I should have said this. So this is, I was saying here, what you, this integral that we're discussing here, so the z variable is the integral over the unfixed punctures. So when you in the picture here, of course, there are integrals over z for all the punctures, but you can fix three, but then you're in for the 4 point, you're left with one integral, and this integral you still have to sort of disentangle into the two parts. And the real part is very easy to immediately turn into an open string integral, and for the other one you have to do this analytic continuation. It comes from the punctures. Yeah.
Okay. And I'm also a bit confused about this. I mean, you have these two copies, A and A tilde, and they come from these two halves, I mean, two semi-sphere, right?
Yeah.
And this one with one amplitude, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and the other one, it is 1, 2, 4, 3. So
that's right. Yeah.
Intuitively, I would guess it should be, I don't know, maybe 4, 3, 2, 1, but it's kind of different orientation and way. Of course, this has to do with having, you know, one U channel and the other, T channel, but. How can I see that intuitively or more easily?
So intuitively, why? So let's go to the where's this? The picture and the general mm-hmm. formula. Mm-hmm. So here you see in this general formula, I already anticipated that one good choice for making this parameterization is that you have to invert these last two things, and that's a choice.
I see.
There you can also find a different interpretation where, let's say, you do something with the first one and the last one or something. There's a certain convention
I
that
see,
you have
I
to
see.
Uh-huh. But in the picture, it's a bit surprising. I agree that when you think of just looking at these vertex operators here, and you're pulling them apart into the holomorphic and anti-holomorphic part for the two things, somehow it should just be a reversal of the ordering. But it turns out that in order to allow, I mean, all possible structures of the poles and how you deform the contours, you have to actually allow for all possible orderings of the unfixed punctures. And that's why you have actually independent, which is also something that might be a bit surprising, independent ways of ordering the points on the two open string copies. And it turns out that there is some flip in the orientation. I mean, this is clear from the argument you gave, that there something that looks cyclic from one side looks anticyclic from the other side, but then there are additional permutations that come in from the way that you cross the different punctures. So I don't know how intuitive this is as an answer to your question. Here, the fact that it was 1, 2, 3, 4 and 1, 2, 4, 3, this just came from the way that I wrote this formula. So another thing that you could have done, if you want to have the other convention, I mean, here I chose S, U, and T in this order. I could have taken, let's say, T, U, and S. And then this KLT matrix would have depended not on the S Mandelstam variable, but on another one. So in some sense, the Mandelstam variable that enters in the particular KLT matrix, this is related to the ordering that you choose here. And here, this was just a choice that I made for this calculation. And I should say, I mean, this or just flipping the last two points, I mean, this is something that is very conventional, and it's a convention that is quite common, but it's just a convention.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, I want to ask a question. Like, when you derive this KLT matrix, like in usual field theory case, like it is probably understood as like some bi-adjoint scalar amplitudes inverse kind of stuff. So here, like, can one understand this trigonometric function to have some amplitude interpretation of some theories?
No. So there are two things I can answer to that. So one thing is that clearly this this trigonometric function, I mean, that it's a trigonometric function, if you look at the field theory limit of this, since the variable S depends on alpha primed, I mean, in field theory, this will just go to a number.
Okay.
So when I say number, it just goes to. I don't want to say number. It just goes to in the linear approximation. I mean, this just goes to S, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is no longer a trigonometric function. This double copy in field theory, the way that it works, since you mentioned the bi-adjoint scalar, is. What you do is you take you find a representation of the amplitude that satisfies the so-called BCJ relation, which is you take the amplitude and you write it in terms of something in the denominator. And this is for color ordered amplitudes again. And then you want to have the numerator, which typically involves some kinematic data like polarizations and momenta to satisfy also something that is very close to Jacobi identity, or that is basically the Jacobi identity of something that doesn't, I mean, you could think of as the kinematic symmetry group, but of course there's no such thing. But there's this double copy proceeds through finding a representation or a choice of basis integrals where you have the numerator factors also satisfying certain Jacobi-like relations. And when you glue them together, indeed, I mean, you have to put in some function here in between. So you find two amplitudes that look like this. And here you find a function which is just expressed in terms of this some KLT kind of matrix, but let's see. So yeah, let's make a small parenthesis to see if I can answer your question in a better way. So what you find is what you do is you find the amplitude in a way where you have numerator factors, let's say Ni, and you have some denominator factors. And you also have color factors. So here, this is sort of a representation of this integrand of the amplitude. And the color factor, since these are like structure constants, they satisfy some Jacobi identities, and the n's you also want to have to satisfy some Jacobi identities. So this is how you would compute the form gauge amplitude would look like. And then to get the closed or gravity amplitude, what you do, for example, is you take a sum where you replace one of the color factors by another numerator, kinematic numerator factor. So this is this, you double copy just the information from the gauge amplitude to get a gravity amplitude. And it turns out that you can do this for many different theories. Namely, you can do this for any theory that does admit a decomposition of this type, and then you can just square it up. So you could do this not only for gauge theories, you could do it for these adjoint scalar field theories. And then this is sort of the minimal kinematic information that you have to feed in, and then you can just square these theories and get different amplitudes. And depending on what you do, I mean, you can go to n equals 8 super young Mills, or you can go to some other non-supersymmetric field theories. And I think in this context there, to come back to your question, there is no, I think there is no, I might be wrong, but I don't think there's a way of understanding this matrix that comes here as being associated with a certain particular theory, that you can just compute this from a different theory. I mean, this is a universal matrix that comes in and that you have to use, but here, when you're in this formulation here, once you found this BCJ form of the, let's say, the gauge amplitude, you just take this formula here and you square it up. I believe that's true. I don't know whether this is in agreement with what you have in mind.
Okay. I think, thank you. Like, yeah, I have in mind this thing because I think in CHOI formulation, like they have some interpretation of this multiplicative, this factor, which is the KLT matrix has some inverse of bi-adjoint scalar amplitudes kind of stuff. But okay, it's fine. I think, yeah.
Okay, so maybe I don't, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, also there was a question from the chatting room. So from the typing, if you open the chatting window.
Yes. Is this a KLT representation of some group or algebra? So this, the answer is, I don't think so. So this is, so what is being, I don't think it's a representation of an algebra. So what enters here is the property that when you take these contours and you deform them, you get relations. So there are relations that determine the KLT matrix, and they go by the name monodromy relations. Because really the structure or the pole structure of the integrand, and when you deform the contours, this is really what determines this matrix, as you can see from this heuristic argument that I was giving. And in general, I mean, when you have a higher point amplitude, there is, of course, there can be many different poles, and you have to be very careful of how you do this. And there are relations that come from this that are called monotropy relations. But I don't think there's it's a representation of an algebra. Now, there's another thing that we will talk about in a second, which is that, I mean, there is some other way of looking at this relation between open and closed strings, which is not the KLT matrix, but a different prescription. And that is related to something also in complex analysis, where there is some algebra structure underlying it, a certain Hopf algebra, which I will not, which I was not planning to discuss in detail. So there's some algebra that you can use in some alphabets, but the KLT matrix itself, I think, is not a representation. Okay, thank you. Okay, if there are no other questions at this point, let's go on. So I will make some more general remarks on string amplitudes now and their structure. So and we're taking a broader view now after these specific examples. So the first thing that already was hinted at a number of occasions is the low energy limit of these things. So what is the relation between string scattering amplitudes and field theory amplitudes? So the string amplitudes that we saw were given by some exact functions let's say of the form gamma 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 divided by gamma 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 of the Mandelstam variables. And these were formulas for scattering of massless gains, massless states. Either the gauge bosons or the gravitons in open or closed string theory. And what we can do is now we can consider the low energy limit. And from the definition of, that I gave of the Mandelstam variables, what this corresponds to is to say that Mandelstam variables Sij, which let's say in the closed string, they look like this, which is the same as minus for massless states. If we make this dimensionless quantity very small. So if this is, if the Mandelstam variables are very small, this is clearly where very little energy is involved. And we want to do this for all Sij at the same time. And what this should correspond to, so what is the physical interpretation of this limit? This means that you're integrating out, or you're disentangling, but it's more like an integrating out of the massive states of the string to obtain an effective description just for the massless modes. It's written like this, so just for so. I mean, if we have an explicit expression in terms of these gamma functions, it's not so hard to do this in practice. So for the four graviton amplitude that we saw, which was of the form 1 divided by STU, 1 minus S, 1 minus T, 1 minus U, divided by 1 plus s, 1 plus t, 1 plus u. You only have to expand the gamma functions for small arguments. And if you do this, you get 1 stu plus a constant, which is 2 times zeta 3 plus zeta 5 times sigma 2 plus 2/3 zeta 3 squared sigma 3 plus and so on. And these sigma 2 and sigma 3 that I've written here, they are symmetric polynomials of the Mandelstam variables, namely one is quadratic and the other one is cubic. That's where the subscripts come from. So this is just from expanding out the gamma functions, which you can do by hand or using some mathematics. And this is the zeta here is the Riemann zeta function. Okay, so at this point, this is just a mathematical true statement. And now the point is that we want to give an interpretation to this expansion. So every term in this expansion, you see, since there are orders of alpha prime contained in the Mandelstam variable, to make them dimensionless, you can think of these terms when you go from something that doesn't have any Mandelstam variables to this quadratic term, for example. This is increasing the order of alpha primes in a low energy expansion. And the effective action now should be constructed in such a way that it should be a field theory, a space-time theory of gravitons that has different powers of alpha prime, and each power in alpha prime should correspond or reproduce, if you use the effective action to compute a scattering amplitudes, it should reproduce the same structure for the amplitude. So it's well known that the lowest order term, or the the lowest order approximation to string theory at low energies is given by supergravity, and this is also something that you can see from what I was writing here. Namely, this part, this is just what you would get from a supergravity computation. And then the next order terms, they're all higher derivative corrections to that. So the same amplitude comes from an effective action. And now this is, I emphasize, an action that is not a string theory, but it's something that is a field theory. So it's a space-time action. And the action here in this, for the terms that I've written, looks as follows. So there's a coupling constant, kappa 10, the Newton constant in 10 dimension. And I'm only writing the gravity terms. So this is the placeholder for the supergravity part, then three orders higher in alpha prime, there will be this coefficient 2 zeta 3. And it contracts something that has to have the right dimension. So let's talk about this. The comparison between these two terms, this is what I'm looking at right now. There are three powers of alpha primed that differ because every Mandelstam variable has one alpha primed. This is where this alpha prime cube comes from. Alpha primed has dimension length squared. So alpha prime cubed has six orders of length compared to the leading term. So that means that what I'm writing here has to have six additional derivatives compared to the leading term. And the Riemann or Ricci tensor here, this has two derivatives. So I need a total of eight derivatives. And the way to get eight derivatives, it turns out to be correct, is by taking just four powers of Riemann tensors. And when I say r to the 4 here, I should be more precise. So these Riemann tensors, they are contracted in such a way that they reproduce exactly this kinematic structure that we saw in the four graviton amplitudes. So this R to the fourth is not the fourth power of the Ricci scalar, but it's the fourth power of Riemann tensors, and it's constructed in such a way that it gives exactly the same polarization and momentum dependence. Yes, there's a question.
Yes, I would like to know that when we have the following thing, when we have a closed string amplitude, we could have winding modes. And the question I have related to that, two questions. One, it is if it exists something like KLT in the case of a closed string that winds some circle or any some circle. Yes. And the other one, if it exists some effective theory for these cases of winding modes.
Let me answer the second question first, because I know the answer certainly to that one, which is that if you consider the closed string on a torus, so something that has non-trivial cycles, then you get the winding modes of the string, indeed. And it's possible to consider the scattering amplitude in that context to compute it on the on this space-time torus background. And it is known that there is also a formula that looks like this, that I'm beginning to write here. So some effective action that takes into account the winding modes. So the effect of the winding modes, they will be expressed, and I'm planning to talk about this on Wednesday in more detail, by something that replaces this coefficient by an automorphic function. So the automorphic function then will contain all the details about the winding modes. So this is part of the answer to your second question. If you take a background which is different from a torus, let's say a Calabi-Yau, of course there should be a similar effect, but the closed answer in that case is not known, because the torus is a much simpler background than a Calabi-Yau.
Okay.
And the first question about whether or not there's a KLT formula in that case is actually something I do not know. Somehow I have the feeling there should be, but to be honest, I will try to find out for tomorrow. I can't answer immediately. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so this is, or maybe I should underline this part here. So this is the beginning of an effective action. It has higher derivative terms, contracted in such a way to produce the right structure of the amplitude, and the coefficient of these higher derivative terms, they are in one-to-one correspondence with what you see in the low energy or small Mandelstam expansion of the exact string amplitude. So for this reason, of course, you can expect how this formula goes on. So there will be a term now which has even more powers of alpha primed, namely, so here the sigma 2 has two more than this term, so that means that I have to go from 3 up to 5. Then there will be the zeta 5 coefficient, and then what this sigma 2 is, it has to have four more derivatives, and actually the way, because it's a four-point amplitude, you take four curvature tensors, and you put the derivatives explicitly, and if you contract them in the right way, which is also something that is known, then this reproduces exactly the same kinematic structure of the string amplitude. And so I should say here, this is, of course, you could have written other terms with, let's see, so this is a total of 8 plus 4 of 12 derivatives. Of course, you could have written other terms with 12 derivatives. Let's say you take 6 curvature tensors. But these terms are not what are being determined from here, because this is something that contributes to the four-point amplitude. So everything that is determined by the four-point amplitude in terms of higher derivative effective actions has to have just four curvature tensors, because every curvature tensor is one of these external gravitons in the linearized approximation. these other terms R to the six. I mean, of course, they do exist, but these are determined by six-point scattering. So this is something that is now this effective action that you can write down order by order in this expansion. And to determine these coefficients, they come from the string scattering amplitude. So this is goes back to something that we were also mentioning last week, I think, which is that string theory does predict an effective field theory, and it predicts an effective field theory with exact coefficients. So not any any odd completion or modification of the low energy theory will do, but string theory gives you a very precise set of counter terms, or sorry, correction terms. So these are, let me write this maybe in words. So string theory predicts, sure whether very is meaningful, precise terms at the higher derivative order. And something that I would also like to mention here is that this interpretation of this low energy limit, in some sense, what you're doing mathematically is you're sending alpha prime to zero. Of course, this is not meaningful because it's a dimensionful variable, but this is sort of the expansion scheme. That's why it's often called the alpha prime expansion. The proper expansion scheme is, as we were seeing, in terms of small Mandelstam variables when they're dimensionless. But since alpha primed is like the string length, this limit is like taking the string length to zero. So this is really when you make the string very, very small, so then it looks like a point particle. That's why in this limit, you get a theory which is no longer a string theory, but you get something that is a point particle theory, a quantum field theory. And in this limit also, let's draw a four-point diagram. This Riemann surface, which is the string theory object, if you make the string very, very small, of course, the Riemann surface becomes just a graph, but it can become a graph in many different ways. So it can be a graph. Now comes the hard one. Let's say for all these different channels. And now this alpha primed expansion, what this tells you is what you're scattering are massless external states that come into the diagram, but the effect of the higher alpha prime terms are due to the fact that in string theory, there are not only massless states, but there are also massive states. So even though you're taking this limit when alpha primed or the string length goes to zero, when you consider what is there in string theory, you can also exchange massive string states. So this is certainly something that we've seen from looking at the pole structure of the string amplitude and so on. I mean, there are all these, the spectrum includes all these massive string states, and they can be also exchanged. And now if you want to write down an effective theory, I mean, you have a theory of massless and many massive states. If you want to write down an effective theory at low energies, what you do is you integrate out the massive states and you replace this kind of diagram here, where you would have an exchange of massive string states, you would replace this by an effective, let's keep the color, a new vertex, which is the effect of the, let's say, the first massive states, or the, which is a new four-point vertex that you add to your theory. And this would be now this alpha prime cubed times r to the fourth. So you represent the effect of integrating out the massive states. It introduces new interactions into your effective theory with new vertices, which summarize the contribution of the massive states. And this is what this this alpha prime expansion up here does. So it has new vertices, new effective corrections, which come from these massive string states. This is sort of the physical picture, the physical origin of this. This low energy approximation. And then maybe I can also just add to this related to the discussion we had a moment ago, which is that the KT relations for alpha prime to zero gives some field theory. Relations and the low energy limit of the closed string is this supergravity, and the low energy limit of the open string is super Young Mills. So this means that you get a relation which is like amplitudes and supergravity. They are like super Young Mills amplitudes. Squared, which is, as was said already a moment ago, this is this gravity is the double copy or the square of super Young Mills slogan. So this is how you get the slogan, as I was saying, by taking the field theory limit of alpha prime to zero. So just 1 second. So the this is a tree level statement. And I mentioned already, but let me write it down. So the extension of KLT to loop level is not known. But in field theory, you have, let me just write BCJ, so Byrne, Carrasco, Johansson. Maybe you should write out the names once. You also get these for loop amplitudes. And this has been checked up to 4 and 5 points. Sorry, 4 and 5 loops. Okay, so now we have some understanding of this low energy expansion. This I can also summarize in a slightly different way or in a different slogan, which is often called the double expansion of amplitudes or string amplitudes. Okay, so let's draw a picture. Oh, sorry. So the picture is that it's, since it's a double expansion, it's a two-dimensional picture, and on one axis I will put the perturbative loop order. So this is an expansion in the string coupling constant, and in the other direction goes the alpha primed expansion. So this is the energy scale, if you wish, or the low energy approximation, and this is governed by the powers in alpha primed. So let's say we do this at a given loop order. Let's say this is the tree level picture, so this is a sphere, then you get all these different terms and different orders in alpha prime. This is what I was just writing out above. So this would be, let's say, the first non-trivial order is this 2 zeta 3, which is a very characteristic thing. Then there's the zeta 5 and so on. So you can really pick out all the different terms of this amplitude order by order in alpha prime. And at the same time, you can try to do the same thing for the loop amplitude. So if you take a genus one surface, or genus two surface, let me draw this again. And so on. So you can ask the question for any given order in alpha primed and any given order in the string coupling, what is the contribution of the amplitude? And this is something that you can do for any amplitude. And it turns out, I will summarize maybe tomorrow, or what is exactly known for certain processes in terms of this diagram. So what are the different coefficients that have been computed? And we will also see that there are actually different ways of attacking this problem, not just the straightforward perturbative string computation of the type using CFT correlators and integrals as we were doing now, but we will also see that there are other methods for attacking the problem. I should say that in addition to this picture that I'm drawing here, there are non-perturbative effects. So this is something that we already talked about, which come from instantons. So there are non-perturbative effects in the string coupling. Clearly not any function, well, and you don't expect this power series expansion of an amplitude in terms of the coupling to be the correct, fully correct expression. So there are non-perturbative corrections that come here. And clearly when you look at this picture, you can also expect that there are additional terms in alpha primed, and in this case they are not non-perturbative, but they're actually non-analytic in alpha primed. So these this is something we haven't seen, because this is something that starts from loop order. So this picture with this diagram here, I mean, this looks intuitive, but what I want to emphasize is that it's not the full picture. And I should also say that you could add, if you wanted to, you could add a third direction here, which is the number of points. So you can draw the same picture for a 4-point amplitude, a 5-point amplitude, and so on. And what is known and what is not known, of course, depends on which particular amplitude you're looking on at. And so you could also start to vary the number of points in this plot. Okay, so this picture is something that I find very useful to keep in mind. And now, since we only talked about string amplitude so far, let me tell you what is known in this string, in this picture, in terms of tree level amplitudes. And this connects to something which is known as the single valued map. The horizontal plane in the diagram is actually fully known. So when I say horizontal plane, what I mean is you stay at tree level and you allow any number of points in any order in alpha primed. So this is the horizontal plane, which is just a tree level amplitudes for any number of points to any order in alpha prime. And what is known, so this is, maybe I say this is tree level endpoint. And this is known for both the closed and the for the open and the closed superstring. And we only saw examples that I recalled here, which was for the 4-point amplitude. And there, the numbers that you put on the different dots in the diagram, they are just these Riemann zeta values with rational coefficients. And you can ask the question, what type of numbers will you get when you swipe out this horizontal plane? So the numbers that appear for the open string the open superstring are what is known as multiple zeta values. So they're generalizations of the Riemann zeta values. They're so-called multiple zeta values, often abbreviated as MZVs. And the generalization that appears is that zeta of not just one argument, but now you have multiple arguments, K1 up to KR. This is given now by sum over integers, N1 up to NR, and you order them in a certain way. So they go from 1 to infinity in this way, and you get N, let's see, N1 to the K1, NR to the KR. So the normal Riemann zeta function, of course, is just a sum over one of these things. And now the multiple zeta function is, or multiple zeta value is a sum over several of these things. But what is important is that you order the summation variables in a specific way. And this defines these multiple zeta values. So Ki here is a natural number, and the last one, KR, should be bigger or equal to 2 in order for the sum to converge. So this is for convergence. Now, this is the story for the open superstring, and there are certain methods that allow you to compute which of these multiple zeta values appears at a given point in this plane. Of course, I mean, the more legs or the more points you put to your amplitude and the higher you go in the alpha primed expansion, getting the answer can become quite complicated. But in principle, it's known how to construct all these dots in this plane. So this is for the open superstring, and this is something that, let me see, that has been done in the last, let's say, 10 or 15 years. And what this relies on is a nice representation in terms of so-called iterated integrals. Let me try to explain this in a bit more detail. So the first thing that we have to do is we have to recall that the zeta, the usual Riemann zeta function, zeta of k, is given by a special value of the polylogarithm Li k at 1. So this is, let's write this. So this is the polylogarithm. And these multi zeta values, they come from multiple polylogarithms. Polylogarithms. K1, KR, and they depend on some function. On some variable z1 up to zr. And this is given by a similar nested sum, n1 up to nr, and then you have z to the n1 divided by n1, sorry, k1 to the I apologize. Maybe somebody spotted this. So actually up here, I swapped the role of N and K. So what you're summing over is, oh, sorry, it was right. So you're summing N, K, N, K. N, R, K, R like this. And I have to correct the typo in my notes. So this is the definition of the polylogarithm, the multiple polylogarithm. And you see clearly if you put all the arguments Z here, this is meant to be Z1 and ZR. If you put all the arguments Z to the identity, to the value 1, then you immediately end up in the on the multiple zeta value. So this is saying that L K1, 1, 1, this corresponds to zeta of K1, KR. So this is another way of obtaining the multiple zeta values that appear in the string amplitude. And now the question is, what is the advantage of writing or going to this more functional picture where you have multiple polylogarithm? The reason is that these multiple polylogarithms can be represented in terms of through iterated integrals. Now, this is something that, well, not in exactly this language, but in a very similar language, goes back to Goncharov. So you define a certain alphabet and functions that depend on this alphabet. So this is the empty set, and the function for the empty set is equal to the identity. And then you define recursively functions for more letters. So A1 up to AN are just called letters, or you can think of them as numbers. And these are given by integrals. And this is the recursive part of the definition, T1 up to T1 minus A1. And you just remove the first letter, AN X. So it's just a function. You build up a more and more complicated set of functions that depends on these parameters or letters by taking one of the simpler functions and you're doing an integral of a specific type. So for example, if you do G and you put just one letter and you put this letter equal to 1, you see that this is equal to the logarithm. It's an elementary integral, it's the logarithm of 1 minus x, which is the same as minus the first polylogarithm. So this is now a very simple different one. In this case, you can see it immediately. So you can re-express these things in terms of these so-called Goncharov polylogs or iterated integrals. And you can, of course, now when you make this thing longer and you put different letters in, you can build up any possible multiple polylogarithm. But this representation here is useful for the following reason, because you already see that what you're integrating here is you're integrating something over a part of the real line, and you're integrating something which is just t minus some value to some power. And this is exactly the same kind of integral that we saw from the Kober-Nielsen open string vertex operators, if you remember. So we always, the Kober-Nielsen always had like 1 minus t, let's say, to some power given by the Mandelstam variables, and then you integrate t between punctures. So clearly this kind of integrals is very reminiscent of the kind of integral that you see in the open string perturbative prescription, where now here sort of this A1 would be related to position of a puncture, and also the X should ultimately go to the value when you go from one puncture to the next one in the cyclic ordering, which also tells you that if you take this x here, let's say to one, which is like taking the polylogarithm at the value one, which is when you go to the next puncture, you end up on the multiple zeta value, which is the value of the multiple polylogarithm at the value one. In other words, so let me say this yet again. So you get that these multiple zeta values, they can be expressed now in terms of special values of these G Goncharov polylogs in the following way. So you put one and then K one minus one zeros, then you put another one, then you put K two minus one zeros and so on, all the way up to K R minus one. And then you evaluate this at the value one. So this here is a way of writing K one as minus one times zero. And this is just a more precise formula for what I was saying in words a moment ago. So these you integrate, now you see the only values for these A's that occur are either zero and one. So you either integrate one over T or you integrate one over T minus one, and you integrate all the way up to the final puncture. So this is just saying that the points on the boundary, you have vertex operators, they're all ordered because you're on an open string, and you're integrating either one or minus T or T, which is the way that how these vertex operators multiply as a CFT correlator. So this is sort of why it's intuitive from this presentation of the multiple zeta values that they do appear in the string. So this is very similar to the open string amplitude integral over ordered punctures. And now, as I was saying before, what actually has been done recently is that all open string tree amplitudes, they can be expressed in this way or through these objects. And when I say in these objects, of course, I mean when you do this in a certain alpha primed expansion. So the if you want to know more about this, I'll put down some references. So in these papers that are also in the archive, you can find all the details for what I was saying here. The reason that I'm presenting is that it will connect to something that will come back later. And I should also say that, so this goes back to the question that was asked a moment ago. One way of understanding this, these polylogarithms and how they occur, what is discussed in these papers is because they're related to the to a certain Hopf algebra, which underlies the structure of these multiple polylogarithms. And this gets transferred to the open string scattering amplitudes. And there are things that are called like the Drinfeld associator and so on that take care of how to prove that you can iteratively build up any open string tree amplitude from these objects. So this is the story for the open string. Now the question is, what about the closed string? So here, well, we already saw one relation between open and closed string amplitudes expressed through this KLT relation, but now what we're going to see now next is a different relation between these amplitudes. And in some sense, where this relation comes from is the fact that the open string is like a chiral, let's say, holomorphic object. So everything could be reduced to some chiral functions where you only, because left and right movers are identified, and the closed string is something that is not holomorphic in the same sense, but something that has different contributions from left and right movers, and is something that is more suitably thought of in terms of real analytic functions. So this is the transition that you want to make now, is from holomorphic functions to real analytic functions, which is like the transition from open to closed string theory. Because open only has one chirality, closed has both, and they should come together in the right way. So the point is here that as a function in complex analysis, for example, this Li that we were seeing entering in the holomorphic string, this is not a single valued for X in the complex plane. So this, it's a multiple logarithm, and multiple logarithm as the ordinary logarithm, of course, it has branch cuts. So if you go once around the location of the branch cut, you go from one sheet to the other. So it's not a single valued function on the complex plane, but somehow on the closed string side, you want to have something that is a well-defined function on the whole complex plane, because this is something where you need to integrate over. For the open string, this problem did not arise because the integrals were restricted to a line, and you can always sort of arrange things with your line that you avoid the branch cut. But if you want to integrate on the closed string, you have to integrate over the whole complex plane. And in order to have a well-defined meaning to this integral, the function should be single-valued on the whole complex plane. So this is the reason that you have to make a transition now that I will write as SV of LIK of Z. So this is the single-valued version of LIK, which means that there's a specific way of starting from the not single valued LI on the left hand side, modifying it a bit to arrive at a single valued version. And this is a well-defined procedure. Let's say if you start here with the logarithm 1 minus Z, which is LI 1, what you would have to do in order to get a single valued function on the other side is you take just in this case the modulus squared. So it's very simple in this case. So this function is now completely well defined on the complex plane. So you just add up the complex conjugate in this case. But for more general multiple polylogarithms, clearly, it won't be that simple, but there's a well defined procedure that has been established by many people like Zaghi and Brown and so on, where you can make this association of a single valued function starting from a multiple polylogarithm. And these single valued multiple polylogarithms, they are now the things that you would expect to be the integrands in the closed string theory. But once we have this single valued version of the multiple polylogarithm, we saw in the open string, the numbers that do appear in the open string scattering amplitude, they are the values of these functions at one. So now we're interested in the values of the single valued multiple polylogarithms at the value one. So what you in some sense define is that there is a single valued multiple zeta value, which you should think of as the single valued multiple polylogarithm evaluated at argument one. So this is one way of thinking of what these single valued multiple polylogarithms, single valued multiple zeta values are. And the construction is something that is worked out, for example, in these papers. And I will just tell you what this means for the simplest Riemann zeta. So if you have zeta of k, this is the Riemann zeta function, and you want to make that single valued, what this actually means, if you go through it, is that the single valued map of the Riemann zeta function is vanishing if k is an even integer, and it's two times the usual zeta function if k is odd. Or to give you some other instances, so if you take these arguments to be 3 and 5 of a multiple zeta value with two arguments, which is called depth two, this actually turns out to simplify into a product of two ordinary Riemann zeta values and so on. So there are many, many relations, and some of them are not so easy to obtain, but I mean the exist methods for investigating this, which tells you how to compute these multiple zeta values. And maybe I should give you one example where it doesn't factorize, because otherwise you might have the impression that it always factorizes. So this is 2 zeta 3 5 3 minus 2 zeta 3 zeta 3 5 minus 10 zeta 3 squared zeta 5. So you can always express the single valued zeta values, single valued multiple zeta values in terms of ordinary multiple zeta values as linear combinations with rational coefficients. And now the surprising fact, and this is why I'm telling you all this, the map that I was describing, which just seemed like some mathematical curiosity from multiple zeta values to single valued multiple zeta values, maps open string amplitudes to closed string amplitudes. So what this means is that this is now a different relation between open and closed string amplitudes, which is not the KLT relation. I can just take any open string amplitude expression, which is some in alpha prime expansion, which is a combination of multiple zeta values. I can apply this map here, and what I will get is the corresponding closed string amplitude. So this is true at a tree level, and so I should say tree everywhere here. So this is something that has been proved rather recently in these papers by one paper is by mathematicians, the others is by physicists. So the one is by Brown and DuPont, the other one is Schlotterer and Schnitz. So this is really something that is very surprising and powerful, because it tells you that in some sense, if you're interested in the alpha primed expansion of a closed amplitude, you don't have to compute it if you already know the open amplitude. And of course, the small caveat in this nice statement is that you have to know how to arrive at formulas like this. So there's some machinery for that, but of course this also gets complicated. But clearly from the conceptual point of view, this is a very nice and new way of understanding the relation between open and closed string amplitudes. And let me write this down. So this is a relation which is distinct from the KLT picture. And let me just repeat as the last thing. So the conceptual reason for this picture is really that in the open string, you have these more holomorphic objects, but they're not single valued, but you don't care because you only integrate over a line. And in the closed string picture, you have to talk about well-defined functions on the whole sphere. So you have to have single valued objects. And this is why this transition from holomorphic to real analytic functions comes from. And the fact that this descends to the actual amplitude is something that is extremely nice and powerful. And this is a very good moment to stop before we start tomorrow with actual loop amplitudes. So let's see if there are any questions. So there's one question.
Yeah, from okay, I think. Yeah. From you can ask a question, yes.
Yeah. Hello?
Hi. Returning to your comment of my previous question, you said that the effective action when we consider in a torus the zeta function, it passed to modular function.
Mm-hmm.
I was correct. Okay, but this is a one loop level. I was asking a more primitive question. What about if we consider three level, but having the string wrapping in some direction.
Mm-hmm.
And in a sense, can we have a local theory for something like the Hilbert-Einstein action? Do we expect something there? Or in a sense, I was thinking that this may be non-local, but maybe I'm wrong. Would you comment, please?
So the thing with the modular function that I mentioned, this arises at every order in the loop expansion, in the perturbative loop expansion. So you get the automorphic functions you get, or modular functions, they are modular with respect to the T-duality group, because T-duality is the perturbative symmetry, and this modular function becomes interesting indeed only starting from loop level. So at tree level, there is not that much. If you just compute the low energy effective action on the space-time torus of a type 2 scattering at lowest order in alpha primed, you do get just, let me try to remember, I think you only get pure powers. You don't get any interesting modular functions. And
okay, but my question was about
the question about non-locality or non-locality of the.
Yes.
So I think it's Well, the string amplitude clearly is something that is well defined, and I think you get you do get a local. I mean, you can just take this amplitude and you can expand it out in alpha prime, and this produces, I think, a local effective action also in this case. And as I say, I believe what you get is just a pure a pure power of the coupling constant in at each order at lowest order. So at each order in alpha prime, at lowest order in the perturbative expansion, you just get a pure power. And the higher powers in the perturbative expansion, then in the perturbative string coupling expansion, there are modular forms with respect to T duality.
Okay, thank you.
And then the modular forms, I mean, they contain these Narayan partition functions and so on. And in the Narayan partition function, what you get is you get a sum over momentum and winding states. So this is where the information of the winding states goes, but it's the action, the effective action, I think, is still a local object.
Okay, thank you.
So maybe I can ask a question, although I'm not quite sure how to get the answers. So maybe there's a way that Naku knows how to use Zoom or something else. So this, what I was explaining now towards the end was a lot more about the more mathematical structure of the amplitudes. And we have two more lectures to go. And for these two lectures, I would like to know, I have a certain set of materials now prepared, which generalizes what I was saying now in terms of the single valued properties and so on to the loop level, or attempts for generalizing it to the loop level that I wanted to review. But this is also, let's say, a bit more technical in terms of the mathematical methods that I used. And another thing that I would like to discuss is what happens related to the questions that were also just asked when you do compactifications of the string, when you have dualities of the string, how they influence or show up in the scattering amplitude. And I think these are both active and interesting topics, and I have the feeling that I will not be able to explain both of them in full detail. So I should put a certain emphasis on one or the other. And I somehow would like to find out what is the preference of the audience for what they would like to see. But as I say, I'm not quite sure how I will get the answer, how we can make a vote on that or something like this.
Yeah, maybe I have to look up. I heard there is a way to take a vote or something with Zoom, but I cannot check the menu right now. So I wonder if some other people know how to take a vote.
So in the worst case, there's the raise hand option. So we can just ask for one and then raise hands and then okay. Count it. Yeah. If people are ready to do that. Maybe we can.
Yeah, maybe that. It is the simplest. Yeah.
So let's see. So can everybody who would like to see more of this, let's say, single valued structure for. Who would like to see that? Can these people please raise their hands? Okay, that's not a very big number, but okay. So let's see how many people are actually listening. But so, can the people who would like to see more about this toroidal compactification, dualities, and so on, can they please raise their hands?
Okay. Okay, so it's like there are more people who want to hear about more. Compactification. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So
definitely.
I will be briefer on the other thing and put more emphasis on the toroidal objectification. Yeah. Very good.
Okay, very good. Yeah. So we had excellent talks today. So let's thank the lecturer and all the lecturers who gave excellent lectures today. Okay.
Thank you.